Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Welcome to the forum on April 4th, 2016. Folks, in case you haven't noticed, and I'm not sure if you have, there's an election going on. We've got the primaries coming up. And my gosh, I think in November there's some people running for president and a few other things. Folks, today we're going to take a look at elections Oregon style. We're very fortunate to have the Secretary of State with us. Without taking any more of your time, ladies and gentlemen, Jeanne Atkins, here we are.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you for inviting me. I'm very pleased to be here. I've lived in Washington County for more than 30 years now. There's nothing like April in Washington County, raining 1 minute and bright blue skies the next. We've gone through the March scudding of the clouds, which I think Washington County has a very special weather pattern that's fascinating. And I know we're glad that it's spring. I want to also say yay for the Washington County Public Affairs Forum. I mean, you've been around and a consistent force in making sure that people have an opportunity to be engaged and to learn about our systems for oh so very long. It's been a long time since I've been to one of your meetings, but I know they are very important to the community, and I really want you all to give yourselves a little round of applause for just maintaining over the years and building your membership. So a year and a month ago, I was sworn in as your Secretary of State, to the surprise of a lot of people, including myself. But it's been a very great privilege and a great challenge to serve this way. Before my retirement in January of 2015, I had served a number of different ways inside and out of government. And I can tell you I've been grateful for every one of those varied experiences as I try to fulfill my obligations as Secretary of State. Before I talk about the election season, I want to make sure that you have a full picture of the job of Secretary of State. I know that you will be, and maybe some of you already have, heard from the candidates who are running this year. I'm not one of them. And I hope I can give you some information that will help you ask questions of them as you consider your vote. My deep belief 10 months into this is that the Secretary of State's office is where good government begins in Oregon. Just so we're clear, although I was appointed by the governor to fill the remainder of what was her term as Secretary of State, it's important to realize that I don't answer to the governor. Once I took my oath of office, I served as a separate constitutional officer of this state and have all the independence called for in the Oregon Constitution. This independence is important because of the roles that the Secretary of State plays. As the keeper of state records, and the rules around preserving them and when they can be destroyed. As the auditor of public finance, as the home of the corporation registries, and as the chief elections officer. So the archives division of the Secretary of State's office is the one that keeps the state's records and its history. The state archivist and her staff work with all state agencies and the legislature to make rules for records retention and to use current technology to preserve records. If you go into the archives building, and I urge you, if you've never been there, to go and take a tour, there will be somebody trying to take 3-inch tape and turn it into digital so that they can keep the record of some very important hearing that happened in the Oregon legislature, maybe on the beach bill. In my mind, the Archives Division serves two very essential services. One, creating an ongoing living history of our state through document storage and display that can be accessible to all Oregonians. And their second, making sense out of the public records challenges that face policymakers and the public. You know, it's easy to say that everything public workers do is a public record and must be preserved and accessible. That's true. It's quite another to answer the question, which records are important and how do we store them so they're accessible when we need them? Our Archives Division provides thoughtful and practical solutions and is integral to evaluating the kind of overly broad proposals that can come out of a very politicized environment when you're talking about public records. I also want to note before I leave the Archives Division that I'm working hard on a project to preserve and protect the original Constitution of the state of Oregon. The original Constitution is in a box kept in the stacks at the archives, not accessible to anybody but the archivist and her specially designated staff. It has to be handled with gloves. It has to be kept in a temperature-controlled room. The bindings and the paper is beginning to deteriorate, and we've instituted a project, the State Archivist, to fund both the restoration of the book itself and to create the kind of a case that it can be kept in but seen by the public. And modeled after a project where Oregon school children raised money to re-gild the Pioneer on the top of the state capitol, we are hoping for an average of a dime from every one of the school children, K through 12 school children in our state, to help restore the Constitution and make it something that we can look at. We've challenged schools. Any school that raises $250, we will put an engraved plaque next to as part of the case that will have those schools that contributed. We've also are giving school children questions about the state constitution and creating a file that will remain at the Archives Division for any of them that answer it. So any of you involved with schools, school boards, schools here in the county, please be sure and contact Secretary of State's office. We're working hard on this project. We have several schools already enrolled and have some of them have already raised their money, and we really hope that the state constitution can stop being something hidden away in a box, not being seen by anybody. So now I move to the Audits Division. The Audits Division also has two missions. First of all, the financial audit team is responsible for making sure that all levels of government in Oregon use accepted accounting principles and have their financial records reviewed, scheduled regularly, and by appropriately qualified auditors. The second function they serve is to provide an analysis of how agencies actually do their work. Are they meeting the goals of their mission and meeting the responsibilities they have under Oregon law? In a process called performance auditing, the state auditor and their staff do very specific research and evaluation of operating programs and issue findings and recommendations about how they could be done better. Some folks look to the Audits Division to operate more like the police, believing they should be prioritizing investigations of programs that may be going wrong or have already gotten themselves into trouble. Every time there's a problem in the state program, you hear calls for an audit. Our agency does operate a waste, fraud, and abuse hotline and has a staff that does initial investigations, and where they see an appropriate level of smoke or fire, they make referrals to law enforcement, including Oregon Department of Justice. But I agree with our recently retired state auditor, Gary Blackmer, who believes strongly that it's important to invest resources in helping a range of programs improve their operations, that there are good, appropriate paths for finding and investigating wrongdoing in conjunction with law enforcement, and that there's a great risk in politicizing the audit function if lawmakers or a Secretary of State require the audits team to focus on getting the bad guys, and in particular try to determine in advance who the bad guys might be. The Corporations Division has had a focus for many years on trying to develop greater and greater efficiency for those who are seeking to start a business in Oregon or to do business here. They now have a one-stop online presence that a new business can use to register, to enroll as an employer for purposes of employment taxes, and more recently to connect with other permitting agencies, both state and local, in order to meet the business requirements set out not only by state government, but also local governments. Because the Corporations Division is a good source of business information, it's become a focus of some new questions about whether they should be collecting more information from businesses than they do, either to help the public know who is involved directly or indirectly in various business operations, or to help law enforcement track down potential business frauds or fronts for illegal operations. I'll tell you, this is a lively discussion across the country. I've been at national meetings where this is debated, and the new Secretary of State will be facing these questions come head on. The other thing I want to mention about the Corporations Division is during the Secretary of State Brown's tenure, there was established a small business assistance program and a small business advocate within the Corporation Division. This is a kind of a hotline that can be called when people are having trouble getting through various red tape that might involve state agencies. The program's been expanded in this last legislature at the request of the governor to include working with local governments as well, and has been very useful as a way of identifying where there are particular problems cropping up of timeliness of response or of the way regulations are being enforced for small businesses. So now I come to the Elections Division. I have the great privilege and the great challenge of being the chief elections officer during an open presidential year. History tells us that any year where there's a presidential election and no incumbent, that's when the electorate is most interested and active. Our present experience of this election year bears this out. There is enormous interest and enormous passion among the electorate. It's just that much more important this year then that our elections process is seen as fair and that our results are accurate and timely. I hope you're all aware that it's actually counties that pay for and run elections in our state. The state elections office's job is to ensure that statewide election law is followed and that voters in all 36 counties have the clearest path and equal opportunity to participate. But partnership with county elections officials is our key to success. Oregon has been a national leader in making voting accessible since 1995, when pilot programs involving mailing ballots turned into statewide vote by mail. We have every reason to be proud of our tradition of distributing ballots directly to voters and allowing voters to either mail them back, as is the case for a majority of voters now, putting them in drop boxes. 195 of them are now official drop boxes available around the state. Oregon voters participate at a higher rate than the national average consistently. It's been slow to have other states join us, but now Washington, Colorado, and California have joined us in this effort to support participation by mail distribution of ballots. We also followed up on that pioneering program by creating the opportunity to register to vote online. You may be surprised to learn that that's an opportunity that still does not exist in many states. I've been to a couple of National Association of Secretary of State meetings, and there are states that are still thinking about it. The fear of electronics is widespread. The secretaries who are from states that have electronic registration of voters try to reassure the states that are coming on board that their voter records are much more accurate electronically than they are relying totally on paper systems. And that's beginning slowly to be believed. And now we have instituted Oregon Motor Voter, the first in the nation, unique process that begins an automatic voter registration process for anyone who is not currently registered when they go to the DMV and seek to get or renew a driver's license, a permit, or an ID card. The law establishing Oregon Motor Voter was passed just before I became Secretary of State and signed by the governor, former Secretary of State Kate Brown, who had introduced the legislation. The bill set a start date of January 1, 2016, and I'm very proud of the fact that Oregon Motor Voter met its project deadlines and rolled out on time. I want to give a special shout out. I don't think she's here or was able to be here, but Mickey Kawai from Washington County Elections was one of the two clerks who participated on a weekly basis and sometimes daily basis in the planning process and the execution of all of this so that the counties could have a voice in how this program was set up. And Washington County represents a very, obviously a large county in the state and is an important partner for us in making sure that this program rolled out. In the coming weeks, we will be looking back at earlier Department of Motor Vehicle data that contains information about eligible but unregistered voters and starting an automatic registration process for those Oregonians. At this point, the program is operating on a going forward day-to-day basis, so you'll have to wait for some news about what happens when we start looking back at the last 2 years. But let me make sure people understand how Oregon Motor Voter works. You go to the DMV and get a new driver's license or renew your driver's license or an ID card or a permit. Overnight, the data of those encounters is taken up by the Elections Division IT staff or matched to the Oregon Centralized Voter Registration Database, another thing that Oregon has that many states do not, which is one single database that all counties feed their registration information to. And we match the encounter data from the Department of Motor Vehicle to the voter registration database. If someone's already registered to vote, nothing happens. If they are not registered to vote, they're sent a letter. They have 21 days to respond and say, please don't register me to vote. I want to opt out of this system. If they do that, they never hit the voter registration list. I know there's some of the ways this has been described, people are on and off the list, but they are never put on a voter registration list if they return the card in 21 days and say no, thank you. They can also on that card decide that they want to add a party registration to their voter registration record. The data that we get from the Department of Motor Vehicles is a name and a residence address, a birth date, and evidence of citizenship that's been checked by the Department of Motor Vehicles. And so all of that data is all that we ask when we do any kind of voter registration, but the only thing that doesn't come with that data is a party registration. So the card that's sent in a mailing to all the unregistered voters allows them to add that to their record. I want to point out the mailing that goes to them allows them to send back this information in a postage paid, prepaid envelope. So it's secure, confidential, and it's also not at cost to them. So what has the outcome of the program been since January 1, which isn't very long ago, and more importantly, maybe what is it going to be? This week, we're going to be reporting out on our third month of data from the Oregon Motor Voter. But as data we have already reported tells us, we've moved registration information for nearly 25,000 Oregonians to counties since the program started. Before that, in years previous, we averaged registering voters at a rate of about 2,000 a month. So you can see it's an enormous increase in the number of people who are getting registered. It's a much greater growth rate than all our other registration methods have brought in recent years. Bottom line, a much higher percentage of eligible Oregonians will actually be registered on Election Day, both in May and then again in November. Newly arrived Oregonians from other states no longer have to take a separate action to register and no longer risk missing the registration deadline, which is 21 days before an election. This year, that's April 26. Keep that in mind for anybody that you know. Your registration is set in stone, or your lack of registration is set in stone on April 26th for the May primary. There'll be another deadline for the general. So one question I'm often asked is whether these Oregon Motor Voter registrants will actually vote. Well, nobody's done this before, so there really is no way to project in what way this kind of direct outreach and an automatic process will affect people's voting behavior. Some of these folks may eventually have registered anyway. But those who may not have, now that they have gotten a direct invitation to participate and then likely have been contacted by campaigns because they are on the list of electorate, Who knows what difference that will make? Another change for the Secretary of State's office and the County Elections Office in this election year is the addition of a third major party. The significance of the Independent Party of Oregon gaining enough members to be treated legally like the Republican and the Democratic parties is really this. Their primary elections will be run by counties and be governed by state major party laws. One thing that it's important to understand is that the Independent Party doesn't have a national party structure it belongs to, and they will not have members running in all races in this their first time out, like a presidential, for president, for instance. But the other side of the coin is the fact that they have welcomed non-affiliated voters into their primary, and there will be a write-in opportunity, as there is for all races, for all parties, even when there's no candidate or candidates filed. Because of these new factors in our system, a rapidly growing potential electorate, and a third major party with an open primary system, we took an important additional communication step this season. Building on this decision that Secretary Brown made to reach out to all non-affiliated voters in 2012, giving them the opportunity to request a Republican ballot because the Republicans were opening their primary that year, this time we sent information describing what all the opportunities are for non-affiliated voters to participate. They could do nothing and get a ballot which will include only nonpartisan races and perhaps any local measures that might be on their ballot. They could register with one of the major parties, Republican, Democrat, or Independent, if they wanted to participate in their primary, or they could return this request for ballot, and as a non-affiliated voter, without changing their party, they could vote in the Independent Party primary. I've had the opportunity in recent months to learn from some of the national civic participation organizations about how important clear education is to bringing people into the voting process. We tested our materials for the Oregon Motor Voter against national research standards and worked really hard to make them understandable. The fact that we haven't gotten a lot of, what is this, calls in the weeks since we've been sending almost 750 a day speaks well to that process, and we're pleased about that. We didn't have quite the same time to gather input before this kind of urgent pre-primary mailing to non-affiliated voters, but we did try to use what we'd learned and to combine a message of welcome and encouragement together with a neutral tone about what decisions that they should make. The response has been pretty interesting. We have certainly gotten feedback by many that they appreciated understanding. If they're new to the state, they didn't know about our closed primaries, they didn't have any idea when the primary was, or a lot of information that people found useful. We also got feedback that folks are still confused. They're hoping that there's an option that will let them vote for any of the candidates that they are hearing about and reading about. Many are expressing, therefore, their dislike of closed primaries, which isn't a decision Secretary of State makes. It's a decision by the parties, but it's an important message to hear. But others aren't sure what really it means to be a member of a party and what labels like Democrat, Independent, and Republican really mean. Another group is frustrated that the official primary ballots don't include, as they don't by law, the so-called minor parties. Where are we in all of this? We did make a reference to how you could find information about minor parties as well, but their primary processes are not something that the state and counties run, so we didn't include the direct information about that, and that frustrated some people. I'm very much looking forward to passing along what we learn in this whole process to the next Secretary of State and to the legislature. We should think carefully about whether the elections process itself should be reformed to allow smaller parties easier access to publicly funded ballots, or whether the parties themselves should retain responsibility for organizing their voters. I personally think it's critical that Secretary of State and county elections officials be trusted to be advocates for voters of all stripes. It would concern me if we were encouraged to take a role in advocating for greater participation in party operations, either for large or small parties. But one thing I'm very clear on, we not only need to encourage participation, we need to make it easy. Through ballots mailed directly to voters, as we're doing, through easy automatic registration, which we're doing, but also by making participation understandables. We need to recognize that the days are past when everyone who registers comes from a family tradition of voting, or even a community tradition of American-style voting processes. We can't assume that kids learn in school about the political process or about the processes of elections. We must invest in our own public education about elections to make sure that the electorate actually has a chance to exert its will. I believe we're moving in all those directions in the Secretary of State's office and at the county level here in Oregon. You should be very proud of that fact. And I think with that, I will close and hope that took up the time I was supposed to. And we'll go. Thank you. And we'll go to questions. Thank you. Sure.
Thank you very much, Secretary Atkins. Appreciate the great overview, and I can see people lining up through the corner of my eye for questions. I will only take a half a second to remind folks that tomorrow night, whatever's going on in your life has been canceled in order to allow you to attend the Cedar Mill Library at 7 o'clock, where we have our vice president who will wave. Thank you for waving. Oops, I'm sorry. At any rate, presenting an hour-long program about political involvement, and it should be absolutely wonderful and very, very exciting. With that, we'll start off with questions.
Jim Cape, for member. You said you lived in Washington County 30 years. The concern is, like, didn't in the 90s you moved from Cedar Hills to Multnomah County or Clackamas County or something, and that's where you met up with Kate?
No, I've been in Cedar Hills. See, my husband and I moved from Washington, D.C. at the end of 1985. We have rented a house in Beaverton for a year. We bought a house in Cedar Hills the next year, bought another house in Cedar Hills about 8 years later, and we've been there ever since.
Okay. The concern was is that, I mean, when Kate Brown would speak to the forum, she would be always asked about the disenfranchisement of Washington County based on per capita demographics and the redistricting. And the last redistricting, Washington County is still disenfranchised. It's still owed 1.5 more state rep districts and one extra state senate district based on per capita demographics. And, like, everyone's just kind of shrugging their shoulders and goes, oh, well, but, I mean, that proves the point. And I mean, when Kate would say, oh, well, we tried, that really doesn't fulfill the ideals of the office. Thank you.
Well, that's an important point. Redistricting will come up again in 2020. I know that data gathering is already going on with the legislative staff that have to work that through. It may or may not fall to the Secretary of State, but it's good input, and we welcome it to be provided also to your state legislators.
Thank you for coming in, Madam Secretary. It was a good little talk you gave. I appreciate it. I don't know if you heard or not, the Supreme Court ruled today unanimously in a redistricting issue that one man, one vote counts, and that it's not what's important is the citizenship of the individual and not whether they're registered to vote or not. At a time when there are a lot of states are trying to restrict the voting, this, I think, is a big thing. But anyway, my question is, you've never been through it yourself that I don't think you have, the redistricting process, but I was wondering, I'm sure you know some things about it, and I was wondering if you could talk about that a little bit and maybe if this Supreme Court ruling today has any impact on that.
I don't know whether Oregon has ever limited its analysis of the numbers to the electorate as opposed to citizens residing. I would hope they haven't, that they have had the broader number in mind, because representatives represent everybody who lives in the district, whether or not that person is a voter. I think that's the good principle that comes out of the Supreme Court decision. But it is it is something to, as we gear up for the next redistricting, to keep in mind and to make sure that we understand that everybody who is legally residing here is someone who representatives need to consider part of their constituency. That's the meaning of that from my standpoint.
Dick Cartwright, forum member. I'm probably one of the confused ones that you may have alluded to. I have coffee almost every morning with some people I think are fairly sophisticated business people. And we read in the Oregonian, I don't know how far back, that your motor voter thing, you can walk in, and it appears that in the state of Oregon, legal or illegal can walk in and get a driver's license, and you're automatically a voter, which we all about went through the roof. Is that correct, or am I confused?
No, that's not correct. Actually, the Oregon legislature did pass a law that would have allowed folks who don't have appropriate documentation to get a driver's card. That was overturned by the voters of Oregon, and at that point, the Department of Motor Vehicles instituted a process, and if you go now to get a new license, permit, or ID, you are required to demonstrate your citizenship legal presence status. They do code according to whether it was a citizenship documentation that you gave them, or just one that's an immigration document that shows you're here legally but you're not a citizen. They do distinguish in their database about that, and the only data that comes to us are those where citizenship has been confirmed by the Department of Motor Vehicles. So the Department of Motor Vehicles data that we get to use for Oregon Motor Voter actually requires documentation in ways that regular voter registration does not, and is actually the most secure if your concern is most about non-citizens being registered there, not being registered through Oregon Motor Voter.
Thank you. Question number two, if I may.
The rules guy.
You mentioned making it easier and easier and easier to vote. But my thinking is that maybe people need to work at it to get a better voter. That's neither here nor there. But you talked a lot about making it easier by introducing this fantastic electronic system. Now, we all know that the electronic systems anymore, they can all be hacked. Ask Target. Apple, I could go on and on. My question is in your electronic system, what have you done to firewall possibility of fraud? Because, again, a lot of the people that I have coffee with in the morning think it's just ripe for voter fraud.
We've had electronic, that is online voter registration for a number of years, and we have had no evidence that moving to an electronic system from a paper system makes for more opportunity for fraud. The electronic systems, we're using all of the state-of-the-art, the most highest standards that can be set for protecting the data that's in both the voter registration system and the DMV system. You are certainly right that there are no systems that are perfect, but I think we have enough, and I can't tell you the specifics. I won't tell you the specifics because they talk about not outlining the specifics as a way of not giving people a roadmap as to how they might get around your security systems. And we've had quite some debate about this with legislators and with others who are concerned. And we're doing everything that we think is best practice in this regard. Certainly, if there's any evidence that people are, if there's a sudden influx, there are patterns that could develop that would flag that for us. It's certainly a more complicated way to commit voter fraud than actually filling out a bunch of cards and mailing them in. So I don't think this increases the likelihood of fraud. We've had very few cases of fraud in Oregon. We have pursued some. Generally, it has to do with somebody signing somebody else's ballot. I thought I could. My daughter was in France. She really wanted me to vote for her. No, you can't do that. Signatures have to line up from the Department of Motor Vehicle, from your voter registration documents, and on your ballot. So we have a number of security systems there, and happy to talk with anybody more about them in detail.
Hi, Jeanne. I'm Marilyn McWilliams, and I'm a forum member. And I wanted to ask, there's some counties in Oregon who have challenges in providing services for their residents. And I'm thinking of Josephine and Curry County, and I'm sure there's some others that have problems. Can you describe how these counties get around the problems of carrying on elections when they don't really have the revenue that other counties have?
Resources to do so. Yes, elections is one of those services that for the counties that have had in this generation are having a very serious problem having the ability to carry out, and whether or not state would have to try to take over elections processes. We've not heard of anybody who's on the verge of that. I will say that there is an association of county clerks that we work with very closely. They are our partners in this whole effort. They provide a lot of great support to each other. We did manage to get from the legislature some additional resources to help with the additional pool of registered voters that are coming on because of Oregon Motor Voter. This may have caused the legislature to pay a little bit more attention to the fact that the state passes a lot of rules about how elections will be held, but doesn't finance much in the way of elections. And I think that conversation will continue. But I think as people have set up in the last few years some of the emergency possibilities of replacing county services, elections has been one of those that we would make sure that all 36 counties had an election. There are some of the extra services that are indeed harder. Some of the disability access for folks with disabilities is very, very important, and particularly in rural areas. But the counties work very hard at that. They use election volunteers who, you know, are sworn in as election staff during the season, and I'm very impressed by the lengths they go to try to make sure.
Steve Buckstein, forum member. One of the other duties of the Secretary of State that you didn't talk about here, which most people probably aren't aware of, is that you sit on the State Lands Board. And the Lands Board has a fiduciary responsibility, constitutional responsibility, to maximize or maintain revenue for the Common School Fund, which is part of the support for public schools in Oregon. The Land Board now is trying to sell one of those assets, which is the Elliott State Forest in southern Oregon. And my question is, as I understand the process, the State Lands Board will accept an appraisal of what the board thinks the property's worth. It's somewhere in the neighborhood of $300 million, just to use an example. But the way the rules are set up, no one can bid $300 million or $400 million. They would not. Their bid would not be accepted, and I'm just wondering how that squares with your fiduciary responsibility to maximize revenue for schools if you won't accept $1 more than what your appraisal says the property is worth.
I'm not sure about your question about not accepting $1 more. Let me tell you my understanding of where we've been with the State Land Board. And this has been, yes, the State Treasurer, the Governor, and the Secretary of State make up a three-member State Land Board. The state holds lands and finance property, money property, that does not belong to anybody else. You may realize that there's more to the land board than just land holdings. There are funds that should have been inherited by somebody, but nobody ever claimed it, unclaimed resources. There's a wide variety of types of property that is owned. Some of that, of the land that's held by the land board, is held in trust for the Common School Fund, not all of it. The Elliott Forest, however, is one of them, and I came into the land board at a time when that had become quite controversial. For the land board, the Elliott State Forest is not producing income because of lawsuits and a variety of limitations on the ability to take timber off the land. It's not making money for the Common School Fund, and that seemed in complete violation of the trust obligation. there are those, of course, and another important element of this is that the forest is used in a lot of ways by the public. And there are lots of interest in how, in keeping a balanced view and a balance of uses for all Oregonians of the Elliott Forest. So the question becomes, what do we as trustees of the Common School Fund do? We can't just say we're going to ignore that and go with best uses that the community would like, all of the various uses of it that people would like. We have to maintain our obligation as a trust fund. And I'll back up and say that when I took over Secretary of State's office and they came to brief me on the land board, they gave me a wonderful PhD analysis from 1949 that was done of the Common School Funds in Oregon. Of all the federal money or the federal land that was designated to be for the support of schools that Oregon got as a western state when we became a state, we now have something like 27% of that land. Because of other scandal, turn of the century, there were people who, you know, sold that land and made profits off of it. Senator lost his job. A very dramatic history of taking from the Common School Fund. And we now have a very small and make a very small contribution each year to the to schools through the Common School Fund. I take that priority very seriously, and my message back to the advocates around this was, it may be the governor's job in connection to the legislature to manage that property for the benefit of all the interests that Oregonians have in that land. For the land board, our one and only obligation is the Common School Fund. Too much has been taken from it, from my standpoint, for me to go along with. We should hold on to it even though it's losing money. So that's when the sale, and I did vote in favor of it, putting it out there. The terms of this are, there will be an appraisal and we can't take less than an appraisal. I'm not sure that we can't take more, but I'm happy to look into that. But we also put forward that we want whoever buys it, whatever consortium or individual owner, unlikely, to preserve the open land that is open, to preserve public access on it, to be mindful of and plan whatever economic activities happen on that land with respect to Endangered Species Act and all of the things that are important for preservation of both salmon and bird life in the Elliott Forest. What the land board will do when the time comes, and I'm afraid it'll be after my service, whether a bid will come forward that will meet that criteria. That is, it will make sure that the Common School Fund is held secure by getting market value for the property, and all of those other factors are part of it, and are the buyers are going to be able to preserve it for all of those things. I don't know. I know there are a lot of conversations going on, a lot of negotiations. State Land Board people are paying attention to those. But I do think the State Land Board has to hold firm that this Common School Fund comes first. The governor and the legislature can decide a lot of other things, but the Common School Fund, in my mind, had to come first.
Thank you. I agree that a lot of other criteria have to be met, but I hope you'll look into this concern that we have, and actually some potential buyers have, that they have to meet the criteria, the non-financial criteria that the board has set. But literally, if they bid a dollar more, it will be considered under your staff guidelines a non-responsive bid, which seems to violate your fiduciary responsibility. And even if you're not there when the bid comes through, maybe next year, you might be able to look into that and change that aspect of it while you're still in office. I hope
you
at least look into it.
We'll look at that. Thank you. Sorry for the long answer. It's a big issue.
John Blackman, short question, short answer. Say I register a vehicle or I renew my driver license, they send my name to your office to see if I'm already registered as a voter, right?
Yes. We go and get it. They don't send it. We go to get it.
Okay. When you go get it, how about the address? People move around a lot. what if the address given to the DMV is different from the address on your records? Do you change the address?
We do update addresses as part of this program, and it has been, and I do think that we're going to have many fewer returned ballots because we will have more updated addresses as a result of this. I do want to clarify, though, Oregon Motor Voter does not, the process does not start when you go in and do anything related to your vehicle. This is only about your license, permit, or ID card.
Phil Nelson, forum member, thank you for coming here today.
Thanks for having me.
I have a question about education, and you were speaking about voter education and lack of knowledge and such, and I was wondering if your office has any formal program to provide information to the schools regarding voting and civic participation.
Thank you. We do have a very minimal amount of staff whose job it is to try to do civic engagement related activities. We participate generally in programs that schools have and then invite us to be part of. The Secretary of State's office at this point doesn't have a lot of resources built in for proactive voter education things. I certainly am going to leave behind a recommendation that be something that's initiated.
Hello, Jeanne. Thank you so much for coming and sharing your knowledge of what the Secretary of State does, because I think it really is nice to encompass such a large area, so thank you very much for that. My question is probably very softball-ish, so if I register and then I vote in the primary, can I change my registration and vote in the general? Is there enough time to do that?
Between the primary and the general, there certainly is. I remember that I looked at end of September date. And once the primary election has happened, you can change your registration at any point until 21 days before the general election. So that would be an October day, probably. And I'm sorry, I don't have that in my head. 21 calendar days. That's right. So yes, you can. Up to 21 days in advance.
All right, I'm not planning on doing it, but you never know. All right, thank you.
Harry Bodine, forum member. Jeanne, a paranoid statement first, and then a real question.
Okay.
I've always been a little suspicious of motor voter from the standpoint that the real purpose of it, secondary maybe, is to kill off the Independent Party of Oregon before it can be strangled in its crib, basically, because we're getting all these, you said 25,000 in two months?
In the first 2.5 months.
So basically you run that out to 250,000 people over the course of a year. So basically you're swelling the rolls, which will cause the Independent Party to fall below the mark and go back into oblivion again. That's my statement. Number two is gerrymandering. 20 years ago, if I remember correctly, every legislative district in this Washington County was a competitive district. Now I would say that virtually maybe one or two at the most are. All the rest basically are one-party fiefs. And when you look at the state as a whole, we've got this pattern. We maybe have, there's 60 representatives, 30 senators, and maybe 10% of those districts are competitive now. Others are all locked up by one party or another through gerrymandering. What should we do about it, I guess, if anything?
Well, I'm going to back up first to Oregon Motor Voter in the Independent Party or any of the small parties, because they also are measured against the greater proportion of the electorate. So when Oregon Motor Voter was passed, it was agreed before passage and built into the bill that there would be a delay and so the percentage of voters that the Independent Party of Oregon needed to meet was established last August and would go through this election cycle, and any influx in new voters would not impact that. in this last legislative session, in the February session, in the midst of all they did, which was, as you probably know, fairly substantial, we had come forward because there had been a typo in the original Oregon Motor Voter Bill that affected the smaller parties, pointed to the, you know, to sub A instead of sub B or some Scrivener's error that we needed to have corrected. Legislators took up that issue, and working with the Independent Party and the other parties and our office, now have put off the effect of the greater electorate through the 2020 election cycle, 2018 election cycle, excuse me. So that there is, you know, so that it would not come down as a big hammer from the very beginning, and so that in the 2017 session, if they so choose, the legislature could think about altering those percentages or doing something different along that line. So it is an issue that had been raised, that's been wrestled with by the legislature, and I expect it continue to be done so. Gerrymandering, I will have to confess that I've not spent a lot of time thinking about redistricting, since it will be after my time that comes forward. But I'm very happy to have all of the input. I think you're absolutely right. We do know we have a narrow band of seats in play every time that may be ameliorated or not by a broader electorate. We don't know at this time what impact that might have, but it's certainly important to consider. And if there are ways that can improve from the last time the equity among districts, I don't think we have a lot of, you know, very extreme gerrymandered districts that are like those cartoon ones you see from some of the other states, but, pardon? Mm-hmm. Yeah, but at any rate, it is something to be concerned about. I understand.
Thank you.
Yep.
Chris Leslie, forum member. Very good presentation. I enjoyed it very much.
Thank you.
A lot of information. In renewing my license, and I've been driving over, 60 years anyway, and they asked me to get my birth certificate. And they didn't want a copy, they just wanted the birth certificate from wherever I got it. So I had to remember where I was born, all that stuff. And send for a copy, official copy, bonded and all that. Stamped, it costs quite a bit. I would think that some people would not be able to have the resources to do that, for especially people from out of state with a large number of people you have here. What do you think about that?
Well, as I say, Oregon has maintained that attestation, that is, signing, understanding that it's a felony if you're lying, a declaration that you are a U.S. citizen is satisfactory for voter registration. And that's what happens when you fill out a voter registration card or you go online. You're attesting to the fact that you are. To get a driver's license now is in the driver's license world as opposed to the voting world. The Real ID Federal Act has pushed states toward requiring that they demonstrate legal presence. The Oregon legislature tried to say maybe we don't need to do that. The people of Oregon said, no, you're going to do that. And yes, I'm sure it is a hardship at a driver's license level. A passport is another
valid. There are a few other kind of arcane documents that you can show if you can't for some reason come up with a birth certificate to show citizenship, or you have to show immigration papers that show that you're legally here to get a driver's license. So it's not necessarily a public policy position that I would support. It is the law of Oregon, and Oregonians have endorsed it. We made the decision with Oregon Motor Voter not to challenge that system and to take, to some degree, advantage of it, to know that no one we would be reaching out to was not a citizen. You can still register any of the other ways that there are to register, which only require you to attest, as they say, to your citizenship status.
In other words, there's loopholes for you to not get a birth certificate.
No, at the driver's license, I think it's a birth certificate or a passport. And then there are some other kinds of arcane documents that exist that people get, yes, right, and that's...
Not because I'm a Republican or use my dog tags.
No.
Mike Mahalik, forum member, and my question is also related to the Real ID. So Oregon got a extension or a waiver to make our driver's licenses compliant. And the reason for the question is anyone who flies, you typically either show your driver's license or passport in order to get on an airplane, get through TSA. So I renewed my license in January, and I was not required to, or not, I'm sorry, last fall, and I was not required to provide any proof of residency or citizenship or anything like that. And the website evidently had not been updated properly, because when my wife went to renew her license in February, she first went, did not have any proof of citizenship or whatever, and she got sent back home because she didn't bring it with her. So she has her passport, whatever. She got a temporary license. The TSA does not take that temporary license as valid ID. They did not take her old license as valid ID because they punched a hole through it. So all I'm basically suggesting is make sure when the procedures change that the website is updated, so when people actually check, they know what to do. Then the second question is, will we all be getting new driver's licenses in the fall that basically show that we are Real ID compliant?
So you're going to have the head of the Department of Motor Vehicles come in and answer those questions, because we are taking advantage of their data to build our voter registration, but we're not in charge of how the DMV does their business. So Tom McLennan he's been on our work group and helped us a lot in setting up Oregon Motor Voter, is head of the Department of Motor Vehicles, and I suggest you invite him. I'll tell him. I'll cop to that I did.
Isn't there an archiving requirement for that information?
Well, that's been the challenge, as I understand it. And again, this is not kind of my area of expertise, but that was what the legislature objected to, was not only would you have to show, but there be a record kept. And ACLU, a lot of folks were unhappy about that, and that's the piece Oregon hasn't done yet. And how long they'll be off the hook for that, I think I don't really know. But it sounds like a good topic for a future meeting with the Department of Oregon.
Thank you so much, Madam Secretary. Really appreciate both the presentation, the way you handled questions, your kind comments to the forum. You know, this is our 60th birthday. And not only were you very kind to us, but also giving us a speaker suggestion was very pleasant. Our director, Spencer Ehrman, I'm sure has taken that note. Ladies and gentlemen, next week we have Kevin Starrett from the Oregon Firearms Federation. If you remember, some 6 weeks ago we had a look at the gun violence issue. We're going to have an alternate look at the gun violence issue on the 11th. And on the 18th, that's when we're gearing up as far as our primary election program is concerned. On the 18th, we have two gentlemen and one lady who are seeking to replace our speaker. We will be looking at the Democratic candidates for Secretary of State with Brad Avakian, Richard Devlin, and Val Hoyle. And then 1 week after that, on the 25th, we have We may have all five Republican candidates for the nomination for governor. We have three committed. We're not particularly sure about the other two, but we have Alan Alley, Bob Niemeyer, and Bud Pierce all committed to be